Random House Audio presents I Am the New Black by Tracy Morgan with Anthony Bozza. This is Tracy Morgan. This is for my mother and my father. Hello, welcome to my introduction. There are many reasons why you might be listening to this sentence. You're obviously curious about me, or you wouldn't even be listening to this book. That's cool with me. I'm happy about that, Mr. or Mrs. whoever you are. If there's one thing I've learned in my life, is that curiosity might kill cats, but it doesn't kill people. Unless you're curious about things like bungee jumping high on crack to see if you really need that harness, curiosity will not kill you. I tell you, what will kill you, people will. We've got a long way to go to change that around, but I hope we do. For now, I can say this. I know it's true. Curiosity makes you smarter. Don't fight it. Learn to learn. Learn to ask questions. Clearly, you've got questions about me. In this book, you'll find some answers. I have a pretty diverse audience, and that makes me happy. I mean, laughter is universal. I don't make a difference between people at all. Why should I? People are people to me. There's no reason why one person can't relate to another person on this planet in some way, form, or fashion. That's something I didn't have to learn. I believe that as a kid, and leading the crazy life I've led has done nothing but prove me right to myself. I have friends who are black, white, purple, gay, straight, Martian, yellow, old, and young. I have friends who are animals, and a few who I believe to be robots. All of them are people to me. In my mind, it's not about what you look like or what you do. It's about who you are inside. I hope whoever you are inside likes surprises, because I've got a few in store for you here. I'm not a child star, but you could say that I grew up on TV. I went from being an unknown, down-and-out comic from Brooklyn and the Bronx to being a regular character on a major network comedy called Martin. From there, I went on to become the most notable black comic on Saturday Night Live since Eddie Murphy. Then I had my own TV show, The Tracy Morgan Show, and now I'm on 30 Rock. And I definitely went from a boy to a man on TV, all on NBC. What up, Lauren Michaels? I love you, B. But here's what you don't know. I was already a man of the streets. I had to be to survive my upbringing. The version of me you see on TV and in my feature films is a pretty happy guy, isn't he? Finally, in my personal life, that much is true, too. Or it's getting there. Happiness, contentment, security. I mean, that's all new for me. I've reached my 40s, and I can finally say that no one except me can take my house away from me. No one but me can put me on the streets. But it wasn't always like that. My life growing up was a twisted Bronx version of The Color Purple. It had a much different soundtrack and no trees. But that desperation was the same. At this point in my life, I planned for the future. Back then, I planned how to get through one day at a time. Let me make one thing clear right now. I'm not writing this book for your sympathy, and I don't feel like any kind of hero. I'm not God's gift, but my life wasn't dumb luck either. As you'll see, I made a series of choices, you know, some were good and some were bad, but nevertheless, they all led me to here, to this point. I don't want your praise, but I do want to be an example, you know, not the kind of example that the principal of a school suspends for like throwing food at a teacher, or the cops arrest in front of his friends for spray painting "eat my ass" on a school. But I want to be an example of a guy who made something of himself, who made a dollar out of 15 cents, like Rumpelstiltskin. A guy who overcame the odds of a tough childhood, who worked hard, who didn't let his surroundings get the best of him and lead him to jail or graveyard. Where I ended up, being a comedian, TV star, a movie actor. That might be unique, but my story's not. When a child is born with a heart of gold, but the way of the world turns a heart cold. You know, I'm still a good person, and I thank God for that. I think he's working with me on that one. In many ways, all of y'all listening to this book who are like me, who come from what I came from, we are truly, definitely the last of the Mohicans, you know. I've seen a lot of my homies that I grew up with, you know, my crew got washed a long time ago. You know, a lot of them I grew up with ended up dead or in prison. I mean, my closest friends from school who are still living work with me or for me, and I'm not exaggerating when I say that we are all that's left from our old crew. I mean, I keep them close to me because they're the only ones I trust. We grew up in the inner city, New York, in the late 70s and in the early 80s. We saw the birth of hip hop right on our front stoop. Those are the good times. We were poor, but for a while there was a harmony in our community. It was that little space between, I guess, 1977 and 1980, the time before crack. And those of us whose homes weren't what they should have been found what we needed in the neighborhood. Hanging out on the corner wasn't always dangerous. They weren't always places just to sell drugs. Back in my day, generations of families would meet on the streets just to be together. Kids like me from broken homes used to be able to find families just outside their door. Among a network of neighbors, we were all brothers to other mothers back when I was young, but not for long. As we became teenagers, all of that slipped away. The city turned its back on the Bronx and let the neighborhoods become hoods, fueled by drugs. My backyard became the city's market for crack and heroin. We call it heroin in my neighborhood because if you try it once, you hook from heroin. And our people were right there to participate in every way, as dealers, addicts, and as statistics, day after day. Throughout the 80s and into the 90s, my high school friends and cousins were taken down by the drug-related violence. My own family was no different. We were torn apart by drugs and AIDS. I lost a lot of role models to that terrible twosome. Dirty needles and a disease society didn't understand. Like a lot of young men in my neighborhood, I ended up on the streets dealing just to get by. We dropped like dominoes, pushed over by the end of a gun or the tip of a needle. If you think about it, I really shouldn't even be here at all. If you're the kind of person who likes numbers and statistics, I'm the long shot, the lotto Powerball winner. I'm the mutation in the DNA that makes evolution a reality. I am the new black. Once you know a little bit more about my story, you'll probably agree that the odds against me sitting in a luxury apartment in Manhattan starring in an Emmy-winning series with an Emmy nomination myself alongside people like Tina Fey and Alec Baldwin on a network like NBC. Given the facts of my life, those of you who like to spend time at the OTB would have put your money on finding me at my age curled up in a ball in the corner of the ghetto ready to die if I wasn't dead already. The Emmy nod surprised me. I thought they'd wait a few years to give this black man his trophy. I figured I'd just keep rocking the Golden Globes. I love you, Europe. I'm not gonna lie. I know I've got a natural talent that has seen me through most of my trials and tribulations. Being funny is my bulletproof vest. This mouth of mine and my goofy face have kept me from getting shot many a times, particularly one time when I stole this drug dealer's girl. Being funny wasn't a career choice growing up. It was just my way out of situations, a way to survive another day. It was definitely my passport to another world that I had no idea existed, even though it was just a few miles south of Manhattan. That world was in the same city, in the same country, a world so many people had taken for granted. But it was foreign to a guy like me. When I finally moved to a nice community in Riverdale, from a rundown apartment next to Yankee Stadium in the Bronx, it was like I landed on Mars. I mean, I had no idea that other people lived without garbage all over the streets. It's crazy to me how in America different people can live just a few miles from each other, but entire worlds apart. I mean, the best thing that ever happened to me was being brought up hard. It's kept me hungry, even though I've got more now than I ever thought I'd ever see in a lifetime. And it doesn't matter how much I accumulate, I'll definitely be starving for the rest of my life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.